From the Cronkite Studios in downtown Phoenix, this is Cronkite News.
As renting goes up around the state, so do complaints. How one Valley woman's experience pushed her to find a solution without her landlord.
Internships in Washington are expanding their reach. How the next generation of Native Americans are amplifying their voices at the Capitol.
And many college students have more than just homework to worry about. How some organizations are providing spaces for these students to focus on their studies.
Cronkite News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to Cronkite News on Arizona PBS. I'm Kyle Wilcox.
And I'm Madison Connor. Thank you for joining us. According to the Pew Research Center, more people in the U.S. are renting. With that, the amount of tenant-landlord disputes also rises. I had the opportunity to speak with one tenant about her experience.
Francesca Sutton moved out of her apartment and into her first rental home in order to gain more space, but did not expect to face so many issues.
The first night that we moved in, my son noticed a scorpion in his bedroom, so he called me when I got off from work. You know, we went to Walmart to get some sprays and stuff because, you know, I didn't know exactly what to do about that. So then the next day, I just start seeing them like every day, every other day.
Sutton reached out to her landlord, but the landlord never followed through. It got to a point where Sutton was afraid to be in her own room.
I don't feel comfortable sleeping in the house. So the first thing I did, I slept in the living room because I didn't feel comfortable sleeping in my room.
In Arizona, there is no state agency overseeing tenant-landlord disputes. When Sutton's problem wasn't resolved with her landlord, she turned to Ken Volt. Ken Volt is the founder of Arizona Tenants Advocates. He has been assisting renters with disputes since 1993.
When people come to me and say they want out of a lease, I really don't ask them, well, what's your motivating factor? Why do you want out? You know, if it's a personal reason or it's, you know, degradation of the dwelling unit, you know, for me, the job is the same. You know, I'm helping them. You know, they become a member of our union and we help them.
Volt believes tenants are sometimes put in these tough spots due to inexperience, which explains Sutton's situation. Sutton did find something positive about what happened to her.
Now I know what questions to ask, what to look for. So, I mean, I guess in the end, it's, even though it could be something bad for me, but I feel like it's going to prepare me for wherever I do next.
Sutton is still trying to reach an understanding with her landlord and is living with her mother in the meantime. Now, we did reach out to Sutton's landlord and landlord associations across the valley multiple times, but no one responded to our calls.
Summer brings many things to Washington, D.C., including crops of new interns. And one internship program in particular looks to give Native American students the chance to learn firsthand how tribal lands and the government work together. Reporter Emma Lockhart is live in our D.C. Bureau with more on the two Arizona interns she caught up with.
It's a long way from Indian country to an internship in Washington, but the two Native American women that I spoke to here in Washington are extremely passionate about the issues that face their people and just as passionate about bringing the things they learned here back to Arizona to maybe spark some change.
What I've learned here is the power of being the voice to people who are voiceless.
And that is just what Christina Andrews is doing, being a voice for her people of the Tohono O'odham tribe.
Right now I'm working on Native American issues there. One in particular is a bill which is dealing with suicide prevention.
She is in Representative Raul Grijalva's office this summer through the Udall Foundation's internship program, one that gives Indian Americans the opportunity to work in Washington.
This experience has opened my eyes in so many ways. It's so different than the reservation. It's very fast-paced and it's changes happen and you start to see really how powerful the law really is.
Desiree Deshini from the Navajo Nation is also in the program. Working at the Department of Interior, she says she is reminded of ways she wants to help Indian country.
I was able to meet with people that work primarily with Indian land fractionation and Indian probate, and so that's reignited this passion I have.
A passion to teach others what she learned here in Washington.
It's been a great educational summer for me, and I can take that anywhere I go and educate others.
And like Andrews, be a voice for the voiceless.
Deshini said that she would like to see more tribal advocates and members at the table in Congress to help bring attention to some of those Native American issues, but that the Udall Foundation is really helping to bring some of those voices to Washington as of now. Live in D.C., Emma Lockhart, Cronkite News. Some community college students nationwide have more to worry about than just their studies. The Los Angeles Community College District commissioned a study that found 1 in 10 community college students in Phoenix may be in danger of homelessness. And in LA, it's a similar issue. Cronkite News Los Angeles reporter Victor Keys followed some of these students to better understand their daily struggle.
I have to pick and choose where I park my car and go to sleep because I'm constantly being woken up by an officer. And I'm just like, I have school tomorrow and all I'm trying to do is get some sleep. You know, I'm human just like you.
Ernesto Giannis Arnold is a student at Los Angeles Trade Technical College who sleeps in a parking garage across the street from the campus where he works and goes to school. But Ernesto is not alone. 20% of the 230,000 students who attend community colleges in Los Angeles are homeless, and it is becoming an epidemic.
I've tried a lot of things to defeat or overcome my struggle and ended up in a place of homelessness.
Like Ernesto, LA Trade Tech student Marina Henderson has struggled. In her case, to provide for 3 young children without any guaranteed hot meal or an assured place to sleep. She also has an extra responsibility to take care of, her own education, a means to a better life.
It was damn near impossible to get any homework done, let alone my homework, my children's homework.
There are initiatives in place to prevent issues like this, such as the Extended Opportunity Programs and Services, or EOPS, whose mission is to assist students who are affected by social and economic disadvantages.
They're supportive on many different aspects. You know, I have a place to study, I have a place to come and talk to, you know, someone when I feel like I need someone to talk to, I'm down.
Though the programs do assist, LA Community College Board of Trustees member Scott Svonkin posits there is plenty of room for improvement in these plans.
Some of these programs are successful, but oftentimes there isn't enough help. You know, and so we're looking to connect our students, no matter who they are or where they're from, to the services they need. We're looking to try to provide a more holistic approach to helping students that come to us.
An example of what the board is looking into is building dormitories on some of the 9 community college campuses in the district.
The idea is that you set aside 60 or 70% of the dorm for people that can afford to pay, so that you can then give 20 or 30% of the dorm to people on a lower cost basis.
Facing multiple hardships, both Marina and Ernesto are determined to achieve their academic goals.
There's too many things that have helped, and like, I've just come too far to give up. I'm dedicated to my cause, I know my goal. I have a clear trajectory ahead of me.
Being homeless is either gonna make you or break you. And we know with getting our education, it is gonna be better days.
From Los Angeles, Victor Keys, Cronkite News.
One religious group has faced increased persecution since the 9/11 attacks.
Coming up on Cronkite News, how the advocacy group We Are Sikhs is working to reduce prejudice across the country.
When a story comes in the morning, we're out the door as fast as we can go.
But it's also great to spend more time in communities and produce projects.
From the borderlands to the cities, the reservations, and even the state capital, we want to get to the heart of the matter.
When the lights come on in the studio, we know our hard work is about to pay off.
We love what we do here at Cronkite News.
We're proud to tell the stories of our state.
Now, more than ever, it's important to have a trusted news source, and that's Cronkite News.
Let that bass, I'm moving. na.
Officially from 36, and he hooks it in. Arizona State wins. Heaving one deep, and it is caught. Jalen Strong.
More than 500,000 people in the United States belong to the Sikh religion. Cronkite News reporter Sunania Tandon explains why there are efforts to fight prejudice against Sikhs.
A group called We Are Sikhs was launched to combat the negative stereotypes facing the Sikh community. I spoke with one of Arizona's principal Sikh activists.
Every Sunday, Sikhs gather at the Gurudwara, a Sikh temple. But today they're here to share their culture and traditions with others.
We want to try educate more and more people about Sikh culture, Sikh community, Sikh religion.
Rana Singh Sodhi's brother was killed just 4 days after 9/11. Palbir Singh Sodhi was wearing a traditional Sikh turban while working in front of his gas station in Mesa when Francisco Silva Roque fatally shot him.
We all human are equal. We should respect and understand.
The Sikh religion originated in India over 500 years ago. Sikhs wear a turban to express their promise to God. Sheriff Paul Penzone visited the Gurudwara to support the campaign We Are Sikhs.
You know, hate crimes and enforcing those has an impact. But to address this entire issue holistically, it has to be about the willingness to understand and learn more and collaborate with all the cultures that we serve.
The Southern Poverty Law Center reported an increase in hate crimes and a rise in hate groups since the election of President Donald Trump.
It impacts us all. One hate crime is one too many.
14 years after the murder of his brother, Rana received a phone call from prison. It was Roque, the man who took his brother's life. Roque asked for forgiveness, and they both cried together.
When I opened my heart to talk to him, then he realized that, and his brain together us. And then after that, he said that, if I come out from prison, I go with you and educate more people.
You can visit your local Gurudwara during Langar, a free lunch on Sundays, to learn more about the Sikh community. Sunina Tandon, Cronkite News. Veganism is a diet that's catching on in the U.S.
Coming up on Cronkite News, why some world-class athletes are choosing this plant-based lifestyle.
Storms have been hitting the state for a few days now, but how much longer are they going to stick around? Stay tuned to find out.
Combat is like crack cocaine. It's an enormous high, but it has enormous costs. And I think that we make a big mistake if we say, oh, well, war is hell. We all know the war is hell story. It is, but there's an enormously exhilarating part of it.
We are here for the reason now. This is our life.
the last month, a total of 52 people were rescued from flash floods. In response, state officials are launching a campaign to increase flooding awareness statewide. The Arizona Division of Emergency Management says all of Arizona is vulnerable to flooding. Residents are advised to keep emergency supplies handy, have a family communication plan, and stay updated with emergency plans at work and school. As we anticipate future flash flood warnings, Madison is in the Weather Center with your full forecast.
Well, Kyle, I think we are safe for now as storms are starting to clear out. Now we are currently sitting at 102, and that is also our high for today. Now that high of 102 is barely under our average temperature around this time of year. For other areas across the state, we have 79 in Sholo, 62 in the Grand Canyon, 99 over there in Lake Havasu, and then 105 down in Yuma. As for here in the valley, we have 103 in Goodyear, 97 in Levine, 95 in Chandler, and 93 in Mesa. Now we do have a 30% chance of storms tonight, but as you can see, that activity is going out of the state, leaving us with a very sunny Saturday at 104. Now that sunshine is supposed to stick around, and we'll have a very toasty Wednesday at 109. I'm Madison Connor, Cronkite Weather.
Former Arizona Cardinals quarterback Kurt Warner will be inducted in the Pro Football Hall of Fame Saturday. The festivities kick off tonight with Hall of Fame game between the Cardinals and Cowboys. Cronkite News reporter Annika Walters is in Canton, Ohio for the ceremonies.
Outside the Pro Football Hall of Fame, photos show Kurt Warner in a St. Louis Rams jersey, but fans here in Canton come from all over, including Carl Beck, who comes from Daytona, Florida.
Because personally, I think he's the greatest quarterback to ever play the game, because I've watched him play every game he's ever played. I have a Rams tattoo on my arm, and hopefully I'm going to get him to autograph his name underneath it, and then I'm actually have it tattooed on. And through this whole journey, from following him back from the Barnstormers to the Rams and the whole deal, now he's being inducted into the Hall of Fame. And the day he gets inducted into the Hall of Fame is my birthday.
And that day is on Saturday. Other events here at the Pro Football Hall of Fame include private autograph sessions and a parade from the new class of Hall of Famers. In Canton, Ohio, Annika Walters, Cronkite News.
World-class athletes are always looking for a performance edge, whether that's in training, equipment, or apparel. Cronkite News reporter Andrea Boyd found many are also changing their diets.
The reason I went to eating a plant-based vegan diet was because of animals. I saw a documentary, Food Inc., and I saw how the animals were being treated, and the next day I just cut out meat and dairy completely out of my diet.
LA Galaxy's Baggio Husidic has been vegan for the past 4 years, emblematic of a trend gathering steam among elite athletes. Venus Williams, Carl Lewis, Mike Tyson, Colin Kaepernick, and Arizona Cardinal defensive end David Carter are among its adherents. But there is still a stigma attached to this diet.
Everybody asks, how do you get your protein, which is, in my opinion, a really silly question and uneducated question if you don't know how protein-packed plant-based foods are. You know, being a vegan is whatever grows from the earth, which includes nuts, legumes, starches. Those things are packed with protein.
You can do the same things on a plant-based diet. It just takes a little bit more effort sometimes, and it takes being a little bit more deliberate with your eating habits. So it just depends on how carefully planned out the athletes choose to be.
Husidic is fortunate the Galaxy is one of the few franchises around that grows its own food. They even have a chicken coop. The result is improved performance on the field for Baggio and many of his teammates who are also vegan.
I couldn't figure out why I was getting muscle cramps, and once I took away the meat products, my muscle cramps went away completely the very next week. And when a plant-based diet, a lot of the food that you eat has raw enzymes in it, so it digests by itself. So instead of your body digesting the food throughout the night, you're resting and detoxing your body.
The transition for a world-class athlete to a plant-based diet must include learning how to replace the conventional foods with equivalent alternatives.
I think people start to get wrapped up in the whole concept of I need to eliminate this from my diet, rather than thinking, I'm going to exchange this from my diet.
If you are non-athletic, but interested in altering your lifestyle, the requirements to switch to a vegan diet are much simpler.
I would say for the average American who doesn't exercise like these guys do, plant-based diets really would be helpful in avoiding chronic disease down the road. Even if it means you're a flexitarian and that you just reduce the amount of red meat you consume, but you still have animal products sometimes.
In Los Angeles, Andrea Boyd, Cronkite News.
In the last 3 years, there has been a 600% increase in veganism nationwide. As summer comes to an end, we want to reflect on a song that has scored the season.
This summer, Luis Fonsi's Despacito is the first Spanish song to top the U.S. chart since the Macarena. Coming up on Cronkite News, what makes this song more than just a modern pop hit?
Các nhà lãnh đạo Việt Nam mà nói rằng là chúng tôi sẵn sàng hy sinh đến cái người dân Việt Nam cuối cùng. Thực sự mà nói thì người dân không biết được, miền Bắc không có thể ý thức một cách đầy đủ rằng đằng sau những cái tuyên bố mà cao cả đấy là sự hy sinh của chính họ.
So beloved.
My bird, can't you see? Little girl got a hold on me like
wow.
Baby, I'm howling for you.
It's literally one for the history books.
Enjoy.
What are you doing?
Possibilities.
For you?
Your day is filled with them.
Reach up, energy in the fingertips, collapse.
TV, play Downton Abbey.
And PBS helps everyone discover theirs. Anytime, anywhere.
In the sky. See it.
PBS, we're with you for life.
The Despacito remix by Luis Fonsi and Daddy Yankee featuring Justin Bieber has become one of the biggest crossover hits in history at a time when many Hispanics in the U.S. are feeling uneasy about the country's social and political reality. Cronkite News reporter Patricio Espinoza takes a look at whether it's just about the music or if there's more.
It's everywhere, around the world and in the U.S.
Ay.
Fonsi!
Número uno, number one on the American Billboard.
Go!
Si, sabes que ya llevo un rato mirándote. Tengo que bailar.
I like it, it's catchy.
Why?
Well, I like music with good beats, rhythm.
You speak Spanish?
I don't like it.
You don't? Why?
Because it's too overplayed.
Poquito, poquito, suavecito.
Despacito, quiero respirar tu cuello despacito. Deja que te diga cosas al oído.
But Despacito is not just a catchy tune.
I think it's an interesting moment to have a song reach number one on the U.S. Hot 100 charts. So we're not just talking about a song that's popular with Latino communities. It's also popular with a more general listening audience.
You all know the song?
I know, yeah.
Yes, you know, but it's more than just rhythm. It's more than just music. It's about crossing cultures, crossing languages. Something, in a way, music making a difference.
The song introduces a wide variety of things, and
so I think it's a perfect conduit to discuss language, to discuss culture, music, politics.
A Spanish song with a bunch of lyric, because this song has a lot of lyric, and somehow it's still connecting with people. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I just say language is not a factor anymore. Yeah. It's really about the music.
The Florida singer-songwriter Stanley Serrano couldn't agree more.
Who cares where we come from? Let's celebrate who we are. I saw a mural this weekend on my trip. It said, culture cures. La cultura cura.
In Phoenix, Patricio Espinosa, Cronkite News.
Cronkite News is proud to be the news division of Arizona PBS. Here's what's coming up on Arizona Horizon and PBS NewsHour.
On the next Arizona Horizon, new money to help fight homelessness in Maricopa County. And 60 local businesses show support for public accommodations for the LGBT community. That's on the next Arizona Horizon.
I'm Judy Woodruff on the next NewsHour, making sense of the economic challenges of creating drugs to treat antibiotic-resistant bacteria. That's Thursday on the PBS NewsHour.
That's it for Cronkite News tonight. Thanks for joining us.
For top Arizona stories anytime, go to cronkitenews.azpbs.org.